Hey, thank you so much. My name is Gene Kim. I've had the privilege of studying high-performing technology organizations since 1999, and part of that journey was working with Puppet on the State of DevOps report. And you know, there were many surprises on my journey, but probably the biggest surprise was that it took me straight into the heart of the DevOps movement, which I think is urgent and important. And you know, it's part of it is the primary research of like, you know, when you benchmark 26,000 organizations, you know, you get a good feeling for like what the health and habits of DevOps organizations are. But you know, the other piece of it is, you know, the experience reports, actually collecting, you know, like what do transformations look like? And that's why I've had so much fun hanging out with so many of you, you know, learning about your transformation. I had the privilege of meeting Michael Garcia actually a couple weeks ago when I was at Fannie Mae, and I'm so privileged to be able to share, interview him to hopefully answer some of your questions. So my goal is to interview him for about 25 minutes, and then we'll have 20 minutes for your questions. So start queuing them up. Michael, why don't you start by introducing yourself to all of us,
sure,
as well as Fannie Mae.
Absolutely. It's a pleasure being here with all of you. And Mike Garcia, I run development services at Fannie Mae, and what that means is we're about a 700-person organization that really focuses on enabling speed throughout Fannie Mae to make us go faster. Everything from coding our infrastructure to test automation and changing the organization to agile. It's been a fun ride, but that's within the context of a 12,000-person organization. And we in Fannie Mae, for those of you who don't know what we do, we manage about $3 trillion of assets, which map to your homes, right? At the end of the day, we take those loans that your banks make to you, we create a liquidity in the market by bundling those up and then selling them to investors from around the world, and then we just keep going, and we keep going. And as many of you remember, and some people probably have a lot of stigma around the whole 2008 fiasco, and I will tell you, there was a lot of factors that went into that, but notwithstanding, Fannie Mae and everybody in the mortgage industry had their role in that. But what happened after that was probably even more startling, right? The takeover of Fannie Mae into the government and then the years that followed and the veil of secrecy of kind of what Fannie Mae was allowed to do and not allowed to do. Well, my journey starts about 3 years ago when I came to Fannie Mae. And that was about the time that that all started to change. And it was very clear that Fannie and Freddie had new charters in a way as far as kind of how we were supposed to expect to look into the market. And we also had to change as a company because our business model was now potentially going to be opened up to a marketplace that was far more competitive. And so how do you take a 75-year-old company and make it competitive when you have infrastructure that ranges from old systems that run either mainframe, some Solaris systems that are much older than they should be, Windows of every type, Linux of every type, and start to kind of change that journey?
Actually, and just there was something I learned about Fannie Mae that I thought was actually remarkable was that from 2007 to about 2012, there was no long-term planning, right? Because no one knew if Fannie Mae was going to be around the next year. So it was capital spending, no investment, right? Because no one knew.
Well, and it's even for the employee base at the time, it was, we have a strategy, we just really are not allowed to talk about it, right? And so nobody knew where they were going, right? And it was all at the board level and the FHFA and Congress. I mean, and literally, this is one of the times that it would take an act of Congress. You know how effective that's been over the last 10 years.
So what is your exact title? And tell us about the inputs and outputs of Fannie Mae, right? I mean, I think it's a Fortune 16 company.
Yes. A lot of people don't realize this, but and it's something I make a joke about. Every dollar we save at Fannie, it goes to paying down the national debt because every single one bit of our earnings goes to the U.S. Treasury. We've actually paid over $140 billion back into the U.S. Treasury. We only ever borrowed $113 because we were asked to. And now here, all of that goes back into the economy. We throw off about $11 billion a year. And as I said, I'm kind of the horizontal dev service across the organization, VP of Development Services.
And you have about 700 engineers working for you?
700, not all of them are engineers. I also even have process teams. So one of the more interesting transformations that some folks might be interested in is the governance transformation, right? Taking SDLC, PQO, project management, and how does that fit in an agile DevOps world? So that's been changing too.
By the way, one of the quotes I love from Mike Wittig from the Nike thing is like, my job is to keep 1,200 developers productive, right? And through production and pre-production systems. So it sounds like you have a similar role and responsibility in terms of like your job is to increase developer productivity.
Absolutely, yeah. Absolutely.
Awesome. And then, so when you were brought in, what was the business problem that you saw that you said, I needed help fix?
So first and foremost, I literally landed at the budget season. And what I saw was that we were our budget plans had three-year delivery times. I mean, projects that I would never think of, because my background was internet and startup, right? And I came into Fannie Mae and I was like, oh my God, 3 years? And I mean, and everything you touched cost $100 million, right? It was like, really? Budgets just were something that I didn't understand in context of Fannie when I got there. And the big business problem was, if we were now going into a marketplace that was going to be more competitive, how on earth are we going to change so that we can actually get that test and learn kind of attitude? How can we get products out there that our customers could give us quick feedback on? And waiting 3 years for something wasn't going to work. Waiting 18 months, even waiting 6 months or three isn't going to cut it. So we had to get faster.
So where did that mandate of, we have to go faster come from?
Well, it's funny, because a lot of people like to kind of be a little reductionist and say it was this one thing. I can honestly say that, and I often tell people, if I would have come to Fannie 2 years earlier, I don't think we would have been able to accomplish what we would have accomplished then in the same amount of time. It would have had to take its course. And it was a confluence of different things. One is, at the CEO level, all of the officers were being taken through a Harvard kind of course for 2 years that basically reset their mindset that we can't be stuck on an old business model. We have to open up. We looked at judo strategies, and we looked at different kind of companies and how they looked at innovation. At the same time, when I came in, I was very fortunate to see that one of our biggest constraints was getting environments, right? It was 3 months to get like a typical environment. It was like, that was outrageous. So we immediately—
Oh, you want one that's configured properly?
Yeah. Well, and you can imagine the configuration management was a nightmare. And so we quickly started to build a roadmap of 6 core DevOps capabilities. And we started to prove them out fast. And so I'm very proud to say at Fannie, we actually started to incorporate a DevOps culture before our Agile culture ever really took hold. And once Agile landed, man, did it land. I mean, within a year, we went from, so actually put it in perspective, 2013, about 4% Agilely recognized teams. 2014, we were at 7%. 2015, after we had put in the DevOps kind of foundation and started getting going, 2015, we made it to 27%. This year, we're ending the year around 50%. Next year, we're going to blow through 75%. And we'll probably hit some sort of a homeostasis around 83%.
And so how many developers inside of the Fannie Mae enterprise?
So so we have 5,000 people in O&T and about 4,000 in specifically technology. I would say there's about 2,000 developers at least in that.
Actually, I left the panel session going, why am I making fun of developers? I mean, really, some of my best friends are developers. I love being a developer. So 2,000 developers. What could go wrong?
Yeah.
No, I'm doing it again. Sorry. Before we go into the transformation, give us an idea of what the three major primary business lines are at Fannie Mae.
Sure. So the way to think about Fannie Mae is we have an entire line of business that's focused around bringing in loans, right? So, and some people will be surprised that here, it's not just banks. You actually have just some wealthy individuals who give out home loans, and we have a cash window, and they just come and sell us their loans. And so you got everything from big banks to mom and pop shop banks to literally and people who just happen to have cash sitting around. And so they come in through the door here, and then we have our next window, which is kind of our asset servicing side, where we manage all of these loans that come through, make sure payments are being made. And then the third side is our capital markets, where we go out into the marketplace, we find investors, and we find a home for your loans.
So where did you start in terms of you're building this capability to improve deliver productivity? Where did you find the most receptive audience in terms of hey, I really want to be helped versus I don't want what you're selling. I don't you're using words that I find alien and distrustful.
Yeah, there was and that's the problem, because we certainly had our silos, right? We had your lines of business. People did not want, in some areas you had kind of not invented here syndrome and everything going. What we saw was that we started to bring in these technologies and said, okay, listen, we are going to pilot these free of charge to you, right? You know, to that particular business unit, right? So we started with, like, back at the end of 2013, going into 2014, we started with, it started out being four, but then we turned into six applications with a very simple stack back then that was built around, remember VMware's Director, you know, program now, you know, it's, you know, VRA, with Puppet. Right, so we took those two technologies, we put them together, and we started our, you know, our journey on automating the infrastructure. And within a couple months, we had this cool kind of self-service thing, like, oh, cool, so we can get our environments in. Yeah, well, that was just in our prototype environment, so no. We've got to go that next step. And so, but the excitement was there, and then we were able to kind of start driving it forward. And so it started to drive interest. One thing that's for sure, you could be talking about how cool this product is, but until people actually see it, you know, they don't believe you, or they think it's just a nice notion, or it'll never work at Fannie Mae because it's got to get all these approvals and it takes 6 months to get new technology in the door. But once you actually start to show that, we ramped up so fast from that point to where we were at the end of the year, it just made my head spin. It was incredible.
And it sounds like you were just approaching these groups saying, hey, I'd love to help. I have, you know, I'm going to bring people, and I want to help solve your problems. I mean, was that really the line you used?
Kind of. So, I mean, I think you have to start with, listen, we all agree that 3 months is intolerable. We have to solve this problem. Everybody obviously would agree with that. Now, you talk about, we've got this particular POC that we're doing over here that we think would be great. You had to be very careful with using words back then that associated anything with cloud. Right, especially in a company like that. Now it's funny because now we're actually deploying products into AWS as well as Amazon, as well as IBM SoftLayer. So it's a different world today. But back then, it was not safe to say those words, right?
So you're politically savvy to avoid certain trigger words.
You have to be aware. You have to be aware.
So fast forward the tape a little bit. What were the visible markers that really made you say, "Holy cow, I'm really impacting the productivity of developers, and you know, you are making a difference."
So there were, like I said, there were a lot of small wins along the way. But one, there are a couple that really stand out for me. Now, one of them happened to be we had an enterprise service bus. As many of your companies might have. A lot of you may be on API gateways now, and kind of, you know, started to kind of push that off to the boneyards. But what we started to do was this: they had an SLA that I think they were being told by our typical hosting engineering group. That it was going to take a year to kind of give them what they needed. And we did it in 14 days, right? So it was one of these like breakthrough moments that, wow, oh my God, this can work, right? The other one that was really pivotal early on, so we approached this, because when you start something, you're like, okay, how do we do this? Do we do a vertically integrated approach or do we a horizontal approach? So we're utilitarian. We help the most people, you know, with the biggest problems. And we struggled with that for a couple months, and we realized we have to do both. You have to. If you don't do something end to end, nobody really sees what the future state can be. And you need to take people to that future state, right? It's kind of like what the World Fair used to be to the world, right? People would go and see what the future could look like, right? So you need that. And so what we did was we picked a few kind of easy, but not too easy that people would dismiss it. And said, okay, we're going to work on their impediments. And we started going through, okay, so provisioning the environment, we've got middleware, now we've got the database. And oh my God, the worst part of the database was making changes to the TNS names file, because that was shared by the whole company. Right? Production, lower environment.
Global namespace, global failure.
Absolutely. So they were like, there's no way you're ever going to automate that. And it was it took 5 days for one change to that file. So you can imagine across all these applications, you know, the things lining up, and they were limited by their personnel, and they had resource constraints. We did it in a month. We automated it, and we deployed it. And the whole company was actually changing their TNS name file through a interface that the team put together in a month. Now, to be fair, it was a month of, you know, can we get there? And then a month of actually doing it. But when we did it, it was a month of actually.
So the end state was other teams could actually self-service their changes
exactly
by themselves.
Right. That's exactly right. And that was like very eye-opening. And because that team was so intransigent, and to see that happen, other teams started to say, oh my God, if that can work for them, I want to do it too. You also had teams that are like, oh my God, what's going to happen to my job? You know what I mean? But the funny thing is, it hasn't impacted the the people the way they thought it would. Mm. We've saved over 60,000 hours this year alone, 60,000 hours, right? And that's something we've certified with teams, like, okay, you guys agree this would have taken you this amount of time.
So, you know, what do you see the role of the technology leader being? I mean, in all candor, I think one of the, in the DevOps community, one of the constituencies who I think get a lot of bad, are spoken to in a really strange way is middle management, right? You know, they're spoken of as the people who are in the way of transformations. But I mean, clearly there is a role for leadership. So, tell me what you think leadership is. What is the role of a technology leader? So clearly some of these stories are exhibiting some of that. So tell us concretely, what is the role of a technology leader?
So to me, especially when you move into agile DevOps, the role of a manager isn't to tell people what to do, right? It's to get the roadblocks out of their way. It's also to give them tight alignment on where you're going, right? Because how many people saw the Lego movie?
Yes.
All right. Well, you know, I love the part where Emmett, this little Lego, at the end of, you know, is facing off with all of these superheroes who have amazing skills. And he says to them, guys, you know, I'm just a common guy, but when all of us got together and followed a set of instructions, we could build the biggest buildings, you know, in the world, right? And so I think the thing is, all of your people are creative, they're innovative, but they need the leader to help tell them what it is we're building for. What's the purpose? Why are we trying to get there, right? And then they need to go out and block and tackle all around the ecosystem to make it possible for them to do their job. But not only that, I think the role of the leader is to innovate, right? To be innovative themselves, and also not to be a sellout. You've got to go up into that room and you have to be yourself. You have to say what you think when you're in that room with executives, just as you're in the room with your own team. You've got to be willing to put yourself on the line and say things that might not be popular, but in a way that will hopefully, you know, win over the organization in the long run.
You know, the CIO of Target said something that he's reported to have said, you know, my goal is not to direct and to control, but it is instead to guide and enable.
That's right.
But you're saying something even more than that, right? Is really to, paint the vision of where you want them to go, right? Where the organization needs to go, right?
You need tight alignment. Without tight alignment, you won't get there. And so, you know, what he said was accurate, but from a different frame. Everything is about learning, right? So one of the biggest compliments I've received recently, Gene, was a gentleman who worked in my organization left. He got a great job working somewhere else. I'm so happy for him. And he came back, he said, Mike, you know, thank you for your leadership. And he goes, you know, what I learned from you was to read. How cool, right? I was so excited because my folks are really used to me saying, you know, they come to me with a problem. I'm like, have you read the SRE book by Google? Have you read Multipliers? Have you read the Phoenix Project or Visible Ops book? You know, those are amazing books, Gene. And you know, I certainly recommend them a lot. I think part of being a leader is not to give people the answers; it's to show them the way to the answers.
So let me. Sounds very good. Sounds like good advice. But it's easy when you're the VP of developer productivity, right? Now, some of our engineers for you. I mean, so what advice would you give to someone, you know, who is just, you know, they see the better way, right? They have concrete evidence, and they just can't get the right runway from, you know, their boss to do the right thing. So, yeah. Or you know, maybe even what advice would you give yourself 10 years ago when, you know, you didn't have this leeway given to you?
You know, one of the things that I like to, you know, when I think about this is, Winston Churchill actually said this. He said, one of the greatest lessons in life is to learn that sometimes even the fools are right. And I have felt like such a fool sometimes in the company with this crazy idea of how to make things better, right? If only we would invest our time and energy with, you know, with these kind of solutions, if we empower our people in this way. And sometimes I feel like such a fool. But my advice to you is be the fool. Because.
And why do you feel like a fool?
Because you feel like everybody else looks at you and doesn't believe it could happen.
Because you're an idealist.
You're an idealist. Uh-huh. You're an idealist. You belong at a university somewhere. You know, something like that, right?
You read a book.
Yeah.
A crazy book.
Oh, yeah. Like, you know, right? They say, well, the worst place a CEO can be is on a plane with a magazine because he's going to come back with, you know, all these things for you to do that he read about, right? So very much that's true, but that's okay, because you know what? The reason why CEOs do that is because they're kind of being foolish in a way, right? The good ones, at least. They're getting ideas. They're at least trying. They're coming back with something, at least. And that's your job as a leader, is to not just sit stale and let the team do everything. You've got to be out there. And then you know what the best part is? Is I love it when I'm in a room with my team and we're challenging each other. Like, what do you think about this? And then we, you know, we go back and forth. And those squeaky wheels, the ones who seem cantankerous over there, and you know, I love it, because inevitably, probably about 7 times a year, I will get this email that is just probably the size of like the Bible, right? You know, and like with all of these reasons why something is working poorly or it won't work. And you know, I take a lot of pride in taking my time and reading those, because you get so much truth from that, you know? But be yourself, guys. Don't ever compromise on that, because at the end of the day, if you are suiting up to go to work and putting on a facade, you're gonna be so exhausted by the time you get home, and you're not gonna be able to give your true self to your families. And many of you work at companies that fortunately allow you to be yourself, right, which is great. But you're gonna find yourself in a position someday where you're gonna feel coerced to be somebody that you're not. Don't do it. Be the fool, because even as Winston Churchill says, you know, it's the most important lesson. Usually the fools will end up being right.
Yeah, so we're at PuppetConf, a bunch of people who are implementing crazy ideas that were, people said, as Luke Kenney said, right, no one believed him in 2007. So if I can just tell a quick story. And this
please,
is a
yeah.
Question. So a friend of mine, he's at a large bank, and he said, we had a layoff of 500 people in our bank. And there were a lot of ops people. There were some project managers. But they had 600 open job recs for anything automation related, right? People have been build, infrastructure, delivery pipelines, automated testing, you know, all these things. And you know, my question was, you know, did you offer training opportunities to these people? And he said, of course. Only 10% of them took us up on the offer. I'm like, how could that possibly be? And he said the most common response was, all I need is one more job, right? I just need one more job. And in this metropolitan area, I know it's out there. So I told that to my friend Tom Limoncelli, who's presenting sometime tomorrow, I think, and he said, isn't that curious? As ops professionals, we're in this odd fork in the road. Down one branch, your salary gets chopped in half because you're working at the Genius Bar at the Apple Store. On the other branch, right, we're automating everything, and our salary doubles because we have the hottest skills in the marketplace, right? Whether it's Netflix is competing with Fannie Mae, it's competing with Amazon. Yeah. And I told that story to someone else. That's similar title as yours, and he said, "What a failure of leadership, right? We should have, as leaders, we should have made sure that those 500 people took all, as many of those 600 jobs, internally, right? We should have trained our workforce, our people, to guide their careers to make sure that they're never in a position where they would be at the risk of being let go. So, what advice do you have, for those people inside of Fannie Mae? I mean, I think we can picture who those people are. How do we get as many? How do we make sure that people aren't left behind?
So we deal with that a lot. We have, when I look at my group alone, I have tons of manual testers, right? In the case of that case. And what's the big thing now? SDETs, right? You got to be able to do you pretty much be a developer, right? And but the thing is, people make a big mistake when they say, oh, any developer can be an SDET, because you have to have the right mindset. You have to be able to kind of work with your Gherkin files and, in a certain way that actually, provides the value for your product. And so what I would say as far as advice is that you're not going to always be able to help somebody become what you want them to be. But if you listen carefully enough, you can help them become what they want to be. And I think when you do that, you get somebody who lights up inside in a way that you're never gonna forget. And so I've got a bunch of people in my organization, and a lot of them have gone through training to become SDETs. And I'm so
an
happy.
SDET is
a software developer, engineer, and test.
All right.
Right? So they're doing all of the in-sprint test automation and everything like that. But, and that's great. That kind of coincides with what I have available for them. But sometimes it's not going to be what I have available. So I wouldn't always look at it as a failure that individual didn't want that thing that you were offering them. But I've had a lot of people all of a sudden find that they wanted to do something completely different, right? And all I care about is that they learn. Mm. So frankly, if you're not going to want to learn that, maybe there's something else that we could teach you. Maybe we can help you find another role in the business side. Or maybe there's a role in kind of a process side job. You know, so it doesn't just have to be what I want it to be. You know, people are going to be far more motivated when it's something that interests them.
That's so neat. I'll just wrap by saying, you know, whenever I hear people talk like that, I mean, it has a lot of personal significance to me. I had the privilege of sitting in on the nationwide insurance all-company meetings. There was 8,000 engineers, and he's from three levels of top leadership. They said the most important job as an associate at Nationwide is to learn. Right, so they have something called Teaching Thursdays, where for 2-3 hours each Thursday, if you're not teaching something, learn something. Right, and it's just and to have that notion of like for us to compete and win in the marketplace, the most important thing you can do is be learning. So I just I felt like I got a glimpse of some marvelous future, you know, for us all out there.
You know, can I just mention something, Jane? I'm sure many of you have read books like The Innovator, right, by Walter Isaacson, or one recently, The Gene, which was a similar thing, but for genetic biology.
I'm batting 0 for 2. Jeez, I love reading, but the...
but the point is oftentimes it's unrelated fields to yours that the great discoveries come from, right? So I think there's a lot to be said, even if you're reading a book on gardening. I mean, who says that there's not some concept there that's related to recursion in some way, right? Or fractals or, you know, things like that that come to you.
Awesome. And by the way, thank you so much. I'm going to stop talking. We have 18 minutes for your question. So please, how about raise your hand? Yeah, and then stand up and then loudly yell out your question.
So you mentioned being true to yourself.
Yeah.
Even when the message you're delivering isn't as well received. Can you give an example where you had to do that both up and down?
Oh, certainly.
The question was, hey, Nice advice. Be true to yourself. Give me an example, pal.
Yeah. I know these moments because they happen more than I care to admit, frankly. And it's always when I'm sitting at the table and my heart's pounding because everybody in the room is sitting there talking about, like, let me think of one recently here. We're in this budget discussion, right? And you know, everybody's talking about, okay, well, you know, we're the same old problem we've had before, because while we've fixed a lot of the cultural issues and been moving technology forward and had great success in DevOps, and you know, we're still talking about funding as if it was a project-based multi-year funding model, right? And everybody in the room kind of recognizes it, but nobody wants to call a spade necessarily, because they think it would set back the conversation. And I always can tell that I'm about to do this because my heart starts pounding like really hard, and I'm like, oh God, all right. Okay, guys, and keep in mind I've got my CIO in the room, the CFO, and everybody else, and I'm like, okay, do we realize that if we stop this concept of doing project-based funding gets like 80% of the dollars, our base funding, which is kind of your day-to-day, is like 20%, we're never going to get to a capacity-based model where we can actually stand up teams that can persist. Instead, we have to play a shell game every year of where did the money go and where did the team shift to, right? And then inevitably we're stuck with vendors and vendors and vendors. And so, you know, can we talk about that for a little bit, right? And it's funny because everybody kind of is like got that feeling of dread, you know, when you say that. They're kind of like, ooh, okay, we just want to get done.
Because it's so contentious?
Well, it's contentious, it's different, it's they know that it's probably right, but they just don't, here's the problem is they're not dumb people. None of them are dumb people. And they really do want to change for the better, but the challenge is the rest of this organization that has to come along with it, right? Mm. You've got your risk organizations, right? You've got your different policy groups. You've got your 14 different governance councils. So if you touch that domino, how many of those others are you going to affect, right? And so, but the positive outcome is that, you know, when we're in that situation, we've actually come a long way. And, you know, we're working on now taking an investment-based approach to at least a tranche of dollars. You know, maybe not all of it, but a tranche. And that's a win. And like I said, it always starts with one like little like, let me try, and then you prove it out. And then sometimes I'm proven wrong too. Sometimes it just, honestly, that was probably a pie sky idea and it's just not gonna work here, right?
So is that a, born behavior, or is that something you can learn?
It's okay. So, you know, Carol Dweck and mindset. You guys read mindset?
Fixed mindset, growth mindset.
Fixed mindset.
It's in the DevOps handbook.
Absolutely. So, guys, that's the one thing. We all have both mindsets. A fixed mindset is the type that, all right, either I've got it or I don't got it, and you know, if I don't, then you know, I just shouldn't try. And then the growth mindset is that I'm going to look at that as a puzzle, and I'm going to keep trying and go at it again and again and again. As, you know, and that's a gross, you know, simplification. But definitely, I think this is something you can learn, because and it just takes trying it. You know what? Be true to yourselves. Do that little gut check. When, if you guys feel kind of nervous, you've got an idea, but you don't want to look like the kind of you know, the oddball there, just try it out. You know, just let, if your heart's pumping, take a few deep breaths, use some mindfulness, and then, you know, throw it out there, see what happens.
If I can tell a quick story of my version, there was a, I always had a difficulty saying what I really thought. And so I was like, I've got to fix this. And I so went to the biggest jackass inside of our company. This is a tripwire. It was a VP of blank, right? I mean, just, he always had a reputation of saying what he thought. And so I asked him, like, you know, can we have a weekly meeting? I just want to role play. I want to say what I really think.
That's cool.
And then it's like, well, what do you think my boss is going to say? I'm like, I don't know. He's going to say X, Y, Z. He's like, what do I say next? And so I was basically building out a whole decision tree, a whole mind map. Basically having him fill out the entire conversation tree. And so this was a weekly ritual that I went through for a year, right? And I was having, you know, so that was like the weekly dojo training to train for my monthly one-on-one session. And it was really a fake it till you make it. I mean, it was the first time I did it with my boss. I mean, I could smell my fear. I mean, I was like so nervous. And soon I had a reputation of being the only person who could actually say what I really thought. It was a feeling of incredible liberation.
Okay, I'm gonna try it. The way that when I try to explain DevOps, the way I see it is why DevOps has been so successful and why it's growing. And I see it the same as the Agile process is evolving and became so successful. And the reason, the way I see it from a theory perspective, I see it from a complex system theory. And the reason is because these tools, they give us feedback, really rapid feedback, and that's why DevOps has been so successful. And that's how I try to sell it to my management. I try to sell it saying, you know, there is a theory behind this. It's not just something that we are coming up with it. It is based on complex system theory that is adapting, same as evolution. Evolution is getting better and better to the process of natural selection. So we are in the same place.
If you had to pick one argument that you found the most successful in your kind of selling efforts and you know, persuasion efforts, what would you?
You know, I'm a huge fan of Lao Tzu. He's, you know, one of the founders of Taoism, and when we were trying to sell Agile, you know, one of the things and this whole idea of servant leadership. It's funny because we're in there and I, you know, got these executives and they're uncomfortable because they're in this day-long kind of Agile for Leaders session. And, you know, I have them be uncomfortable even more, stand up, come over in a corner of the room, you know. And I say, you know, the funny thing is, guys, is servant leadership, this whole idea of, you know, Agile and kind of, you know, being able to empower your teams is something that we've forgotten. They're like, what do you mean? I said, 2,500 years ago, Lao Tzu wrote, he said, all the rivers and the streams, they flow to the ocean. Why do they flow to the ocean? Because the ocean's lower than all of them. The ocean gets its power by being humble. And so it's interesting, this whole concept of not trying to control, because if the ocean were to lift itself up, it would lose all of its power. So you have to put yourself lower than everyone. And honestly, I find that if you can take
that
examples.
Works.
Yeah. You know, if you take examples like that, it gets people think, oh. All right, so this isn't just some contrived thing that technology came up with, right? It's it goes back to human behavior and the way we work.
Love that. You sound like Master Shifu from Kung Fu Panda.
I love Master Shifu. I feel so proud. My daughter, we watch Kung Fu Panda and the Legends of Awesomeness. Yeah. It's really cool.
Awesome. Next question. Yeah.
I come from a really traditional IT background where we try and keep things running all the time, and it's very rigid and there's no changes, which is in direct opposition to what developers want and what people want to see features released. And I'm now working at sort of a newer startup, and we have a really good DevOps culture there. But we have a lot of young developers, and there's a lot of stuff that they do and stuff that makes it out there that breaks things. And clearly there's a technical challenge and a people process challenge. I'm not worried about the technical challenge, but do you have any insight on how to foster a culture of responsibility without creating a culture of blame?
Yeah, so when people screw up the central thesis database?
TNS.
Okay, yeah.
Hasn't messed up since, well, knock on wood, somewhere, but since we've automated. But it's a really good point. And, you know, honestly, what you're getting to is you can't do a transformation like this authentically if you don't change the culture, right? And so Fannie Mae, when I stepped in the door, I felt like in some teams where I went to, I felt like I had like an abused person kind of group. You know what I mean? They were, you know, like, you would almost like, oh my God, they won't accept responsibility for anything because they were afraid of being kind of beaten or, you know, kicked out of the company or something. And so, a lot of it was built on stories. All cultures are built on stories, right? This one person got fired because of they did this. And it gets convoluted. And so guess what? Your culture takes on this whole thing. And then in the cooler rooms, they're talking about you. And they're talking about the way that you did one thing one time 7 years ago, right? So it's all based on, you know, these stories, because we're humans. We lived in caves, and this is the way we told, told our children to be safe and not go into the river because Uncle Joe got, you know, eaten by an alligator. So you have to attack the culture by dealing with those stories. And even the developers you're talking about, right, the ones that are going through kind of and maybe making changes, the thing is that's just going to reinforce the culture of the Wild West developer, right? Now, is that really what happened? Now, think about the five whys, right? What enabled that developer to get to that point, to make that change that was careless? Was it careless? Was it driven by a business decision? I'm willing to bet if you actually, what I find is if I can go demystify some of these myths, what ends up happening is very quickly we start fixing the problem, people trust you. Once you build that trust, the culture changes. Until you address those stories, it's going to persist.
Awesome. By the way, just a little segue. If someone can transcribe the Lao Tzu quote, I would love to actually do an experiment. If someone actually recited that, maybe it actually does force people to go into a trance and then in a more malleable state. I don't want to discount it. It's possible. Right? They're not the droids you're looking for. I'm willing to believe. Next question. Yeah.
So when you started the process of affecting the cultural change in your company, was there a particular strategy that was more effective? Like, was it incentivized, or was it mandated, or was it just the pure wow factor that you're talking about?
Wow, that's a good question.
And were there particular demographics or teams that were more resistant to that change?
Great question. Charles, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so great question. So, you know, this is something that having run shared services at different organizations, mandates just don't work. Right? They just, you want them, and everybody comes and say, mandate it, and it just doesn't work. What works is, you know, following their behaviors and figuring out how to insert yourself in the behavior in a way that's natural to them, right? And so that's why when anybody comes up with something, and I get this all the time where a direct will come to me and say, can you go and, you know, send out an email, the edict, something. I'm like, that's not going to work. Nobody's going to listen. You know, nobody's really going to really
listen. You just put it in all caps.
Exactly. Yeah, all caps. Well, I'm serious this time, right? It's not going to work. Mandates work if you have a culture that, honest to God, fears you, perhaps, but is that the culture you want? So what I would say is, yes, the way that we did it was by identifying a great idea, finding a way to test it with a relevant use case. Don't do something overly simple. It's got to be something that people are going to look at and say, cool. Now, when you do it well. Do it from top to bottom. Show them the whole pipeline. So the value chain is complete. Now what you've got is you take start taking people who are doubters and say, come over with me to this building over here, and we're going to go take a look at this. And that's what I find. That's what I do. I get people call me up all the time, whether it's the DevOps transformation or the Agile transformation, and some manager somewhere in the company says, I don't understand. I'm asking this SDET to do manual testing, and they won't do it. You know, and I'm like, I'll tell you what, you know, I understand your pain. Will you go with my test director over to this building we've got in 4250 in Connecticut Avenue and just visit this incubator team? Because I know this team is doing it awesome. I mean, they have it all down. They've got their in-sprint test automations. They've got their DevOps value chain fully onboarded. And they always walk away from seeing that like, oh my God, I want that. How do I change? Don't make your SDET do manual testing. Right? You know, you've got to start somewhere. You've got to draw the line. So, you know, what I would say is you've got to have successes, and then from those successes, you parlay those into more successes. And that's the way you get it.
You know, you seem like I think there's a certain profile of these people who are driving these transformations. They're very courageous. They take risks. And that certainly seems to match your profile. And then I found out you're using Cassandra 5 years ago, right? Like, was that AOL or was
Actually, it was Real Networks.
Real Networks, yeah, right? Real Networks. And so, you know, I'm not saying you're crazy, but I mean, like, clearly, how do you, as a leader, make the balance between someone who's courageous and take risks versus like the cowboy who doesn't know the cow person who doesn't know what they're doing, right? Who's taking reckless risks? How do you, how in your mind do you distinguish the two?
So you surround yourself by smart people. And you challenge each other, right? I think the case with Cassandra was, we had to talk ourselves into believing that we could do it first, right? And the thing is, you know, don't read something and say, I'm gonna go do that. That's okay. Read it, think, is it possible? Do I believe what they said? You know, think for yourself, right? And then, you know, you start to talk to people who are really smart that, you know, have different angles, and then you come up with your own conclusion.
And so we're not talking about Cassandra here, but so what I just heard was that you were doing things to mitigate those risks It wasn't actually reckless.
That's exactly right. You're absolutely right. Yeah.
Awesome. We have probably time for one more question.
I was just going to add to his question. At our organization, it was education, engagement, and that really fostered the transformation. So you can't just present a brand new paradigm shift without educating. So we provided kind of foundational education, made them part of the process, and then the adoption grew and grew. We also had to socialize it for months. And it's a maturity process, right? It doesn't just happen overnight. Just be prepared for a long haul.
It's true. We spent thousands of hours training people. I mean, and we've had brown bags, innovation days, hackathons. It's a lot. So very important as well. Very good. Thank you.
Awesome. Last question.
I think you scared them away from us.
Oh my God, no. By the way, my iPad battery died. I'm like, no. any last word advice that you would give on people who are, they see the better way, you know, especially you walk away from a conference like this, right? You see more better ways than we ever imagined. What piece of parting advice would you give people?
You know, guys, you you're all going through your own transformation. You've got your own problems that you're up against. What I would say is have faith in yourself and never do anything that you would be compromising your values for, because people will recognize it about you and then you lose credibility instantly, right? So as a leader, the only thing you've got is your word, right? And how you act. And they're observing you every minute that you're out there talking and doing, and they'll sniff out if you a weakness. You know, they always do. And technologists, we all know, man, you get in there, it's like, how good is your foo? You know, how much do you actually know about this technology? Are you just a poser, you know, and that kind of thing. And listen, it's okay that it's okay not to know everything, but it's so much better that you raise the IQ of all of your people and not your own IQ. Because yeah, you can make yourself smarter, and so what? You can impress people with some Jeopardy, but that's not what matters. What matters is that your people feel smarter, that they feel engaged. It's not about you. It really, really isn't. In fact, I'm going to remind you all that one day you're all going to die, and people are going to forget about you. And then there's nothing.
On that happy note. None of it matters.
Well, what matters is your experience now, right? That's what matters. So, yes, thank you.
Thank you. And are we going to get kicked out of this room, or can we continue the discussion outside?
It's another session.
All right. All right. Have a great PuppetConf. Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you, Michael.